Welcome everybody to this webinar of Transplant Child ERN, given by Dr. Carlo Dionisivici, Head of Division of the Metabolic Diseases in Bambino Gesù Children's Hospital in Rome. And please, Dr. Ricci, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everybody. It's a pleasure to present you this webinar on liver transplantation in metabolic disease. And just to present myself, I'm a pediatrician. I'm leading the metabolic unit at the Bambino Gesù Children's Hospital in Rome. I have over 35 years of experience in metabolic disease, and I'm actively participated in the consortium in MetaBRN and also in the EIMD consortium that is specifically dedicated to the intoxication type metabolic diseases. And the main clinical and research focus are highlighted in the below lines. The key points of this webinar are summarized in the slides. The metabolic disease represents an important, albeit minor, indication for liver transplantation. The initial focus were limited to disorders causing structural liver disease, but now liver transplantation is often used, and its use is increased, to correct disease with no structural liver abnormalities, with the aim to prevent systemic complications. And the indications for liver transplantation in metabolic diseases are evolving and are also increasing. But which are the indications for liver transplantation option in metabolic disease? Life expectancy, metabolic instability, the burden of disease in terms of quality of life, growth failure or impairment, reversible neurodevelopment impairment, risk of irreversible organ damage, in particular neurological, renal, and cardiovascular, and risk of malignancy, but probably many others. But which are the considerations to be taken into account for the option of liver transplantation and metabolic disease? And in particular, I focus my attention on the long-term disease course and prognosis, the impact on quality of life in terms of dietary restriction, use of medications, risk of decompensation, risk of irreversible long-term organ damage, in particular at the level of central nervous system, of the heart, kidney, and digestive system, and of course, success of transplantation. If we see the disease course in organic aciduria, you can see that patients have a very stormy disease course with recurrent episode of metabolic decompensation that in some cases may be fatal. And if we combine the risk of mortality with the risk of neurological impairment, you see that there is a progressive development of neurological impairment in this specific disease category. And according to the classification proposed by Patrick McKiernan a few years ago, I made some changes, but we can consider that the categories of metabolic disease that can be considered for liver transplantation can be roughly separated into main groups. The diseases where the metabolic defect is confined to the liver, and the diseases where systemic or extrahepatic expression of the metabolic defect. But for both of the disease category, we can consider that there are diseases with liver structural abnormalities and diseases without liver structural abnormalities. I don't want to enter into details of this slide, but of course it is important to focus our attention on these four groups of diseases. And I want to highlight the importance of these two recent papers. The first one, made by Patrick McKiernan and colleagues in the States, shows the evolving trends in liver transplant for metabolic disease in the United States from the 80s to 2017. And as you can see, the conclusion of this work, the indication for liver transplantation in metabolic diseases are evolving, and liver transplantation is increasingly used for phenotypic disease correction. Children compared to adults experience a six-fold increase in the liver disease, in liver transplantation for metabolic diseases without structural liver disease. And you can see here, urea cycle, organic aciduria, and MSUD, you see the number of transplants is increased over the last years. You see here in urea cycle, organic acidulia, and MSUD. And also it's important that to prevent metabolic crisis and neurologic damage, transplantation should not be delayed. The second paper is a recent paper prepared on behalf of the EMD consortium, and is focused on a questionnaire on intoxication type metabolic diseases, UCD, organic acidulia, and MSUD, sent to all clinically active European SSIM members, the Society for the Study of Inborn Metabolism, that allowed it to collect information about over 250 patients undergoing transplantation. And the indication for organ transplantation in this specific disease category was to improve patients' metabolic control by reducing the occurrence of metabolic decompensation, improve quality of life, and ameliorate or prevent the occurrence of long-term complications. And now I will present you our experience at the Bambino Gesù Children's Hospital of liver transplantation in the last 11 years. So we started with liver transplantation in 2010, and in total we performed 64 liver transplants in patients with metabolic disease. I will focus my attention on these 43 patients that included organic aciduria, urea cycle defects, MSUD, tyrosinemia, glycogen storage disease, and few ones other with mitochondrial or lysosomal diseases. Other 21 patients had oxalurea, Wilson disease, cystic fibrosis, bile acid disorders, or alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. And what about this number of patients? As you can see here, 3 patients with methylmalonic acidemia received a combined liver and kidney transplantation. The diseases of urea cycle that underwent transplantation included 5 patients with arginino-succinic aciduria, 3 patients with CPS deficiency, and 2 with OTC deficiency. You see that the indication for liver transplantation was, in most cases, a poor metabolic control in propionic and methylmalonic aciduria, in urea cycle, in SUD, but also in glycogen storage disease, and poor quality of life. I think this is a very important point. Quality of life represents an important indication for liver transplantation in pediatrics, especially in pediatric patients. And then you can see that there are some specific long-term complications like cardiomyopathy in propionic acidemia or chronic kidney disease in methylmalonic acidemia or hepatocellular carcinoma in hereditary tyrosinemia type 1. The median age of transplantation was in most cases below the age of 5 years, and accordingly, the weight of the patients was below 20 kilo in the great majority of patients. We performed living donation in about 20% of patients and one domino transplant by using the explanted liver from an MSUD patient. And what about the specific disease perioperative protocol? This is an important point. We designed disease-specific perioperative protocols in terms of the use of specific drug for the disease, fluids, in particular in relation to caloric intake, nutrition. Most of these diseases are related to amino acid metabolism, and renutrition after transplantation represents an important issue. We utilize a specific protocol by using dialysis or ECMO in some more complex condition. And of course, we designed a targeted metabolic monitoring. And what about the outcome? We had a patient survival that is over 95% with 40 patients alive out of 41 patients, an organ survival of 100%. No patients underwent episodes of metabolic decompensation after transplantation. All patients with organic aciduria are still on carnitine therapy, while urea cycle patients and hereditary tyrosinemia type 1 patients are all off therapy in terms of the use of ammonia scavenger, arginine or citrulline supplementation, or nitisinone in tyrosinemia. And I will show you here the impact on quality of life by using the PET-SQL after transplantation. You see that by using this scale, we observed a positive trend for all diseases and the significant improvement of PESQH score for organic aciduria for tyrosinemia type 1 and GSD1. But by using the MetaQL, a specifically designed scale for intoxication type metabolic disease recently developed on the behalf of the EIMD consortium, you see that also the urea cycle patient and MSUD patient presented a clear and significant improvement of quality of life after transplantation that was not recorded with the more generic PESQL scale. And what about the impact of transplantation on the entire restriction? That's something that has a clear impact on the quality of life. You see that we were able to liberalize the protein intake in all disease category while maintaining a 6-day protein restricted regimen only for organic aciduria and MSUD, particularly in the days fever, vomiting, and so on. We recommended to go back to a protein restriction for 1 or 2 days. And what about the impact on intellectual development as measured by the different scales specifically designed for the age of patients? Overall, the DQ-IQ level improved in particular in urea cycle and in MSUD significantly. But in your organic aciduria, if we compare the results in both propionic and methimeronic acidemia, you see that there is no significant improvement after transplantation. But if you split the two diseases, you see that the improvement was clear and significant in methimeronic, while in propionic, there were no changes in the intellectual development after transplantation. So it means that propionic acidemia has a more severe neurological impact than methimeronic acidemia. And let's enter into the details of some particular organ complication. You see that this is the likelihood to develop a cardiomyopathy in propionic acidemia. This is our series of 26 patients with propionic acidemia. And you see that after the age of 10 years, most of patients develop a cardiomyopathy that leads to a cardiac dysfunction. And this is the experience with two SIBs who underwent liver transplantation at the age of 17 and 21 years because of cardiac dysfunction, severe cardiac dysfunction in propionic acidemia. You see here that both presented a severe or a moderate left ventricular ejection fraction reduction before transplantation. We maximized the cardiological therapy before transplantation, and transplantation was performed in both patients while on ECMO to preserve the cardiac function and to protect the heart. And after transplantation, there was a stabilization of the cardiac function for months. So we really need to wait for a longer follow-up, but the results seem to be encouraging. Another problem is the type of transplantation to be used in chronic kidney disease in patients with methimeronic acidemia. We participated in this very large retrospective study led by Luca Dello Strologo on behalf of the CERTAIN registry that allowed to collect worldwide over 80 patients who underwent transplantation in methimeronic acidemia. And as you can see here, the post-transplant MMA levels here were higher in patients with kidney transplant alone in comparison to patients who underwent liver or combined liver and kidney transplantation. And accordingly, the post-transplant renal function had a more favorable outcome in patients receiving or liver or combined liver and kidney transplantation compared to kidney transplantation alone. So our recommendation is that combined liver and kidney transplantation is advised in methimeronic acidemia patient with chronic kidney disease instead of using an isolated kidney transplantation. And if we consider, if we go back to the classification of diseases proposed by Patrick McKiernan, we see that there are two diseases, arginino succinic aciduria, a urea cycle defect, and methylmalonic acidemia, that have a single target metabolite. And you see that the impact in plasma of transplantation for both target metabolites was significant and quite strong. So you see the reduction of arginino succinic acid in blood before transplantation and after transplantation. And the same happens for methylmalonic acid, you see here. But what happens at the level of cerebrospinal fluid for both metabolites? You see that liver transplantation does not have any impact on the levels of the target metabolites at the level of cerebrospinal fluid, with maintenance of similar levels that were recorded before transplantation. So it means that although we had after transplantation no metabolic relapses, and in both diseases we observed an improvement in the neurodevelopmental outcome, however, the unchanged levels of target metabolites in cerebrospinal fluid probably represent a long-term harm for these patients. And this highlights the need of new therapies targeted to certain nervous system, and probably small molecules able to cross the blood-brain barrier. And I want to show you our experience with a very severe mitochondrial neurometabolic disease, ethylmalonic encephalopathy. That was a disease with a fatal course related to the intoxication because of these patients developed a very severe systemic disorder with a progressive neurological impairment. We performed, based on a mouse model treated with gene therapy targeted to the liver, liver transplantation in analogy with the mouse model with gene therapy. And we performed liver transplantation in a baby of 9 months who received a left lobe from her mother. And liver transplantation to reduce the bulk of metabolites during surgery was performed under CVVHD. And this is the long-term outcome. We recently published this paper reporting the 5 years long follow-up in this patient. As you can see here, there was a stabilization of the psychomotor development with increasing community intent and the acquisition of new social skills. The neurophysiology, the EEG, the VEPERG, and BAG remained unchanged. The brain MRI stabilized. We did not observe any metabolic decompensation nor seizure occurred after transplantation. A liver transplantation allowed a stable biochemical improvement. So our conclusion, even based on this single experience, is that liver transplantation is a valuable therapeutic option, especially in early diagnosis patients, the ones detected by immune screening with ethylmalonic acidemia before the occurrence of irreversible neurological damage. In conclusion, what we have learned from liver transplantation in in bone marrow of metabolism, at least from our experience, liver transplantation allows long-term disease correction with no relapse of metabolic crisis in an intoxication-type metabolic disease. Liver transplantation improves neurocognitive outcome with the exception of propionic acidemia. Liver transplantation improves quality of life. It is important to utilize specifically designed scale to evaluate quality of life in this in some disease category. Transplantation reduces disease burden in terms of the use of specific therapies and dietary restriction. Improves metabolic profile in blood, but does not correct metabolic profile in CSF, in systemic metabolic disease, highlighting the need of new therapies to correct the neurological intoxication related to the persistence of metabolites. Living-related transplant is successful and increasingly used. So over 20% of our patients received the liver from an healthy parent. Domino is a suitable option in selected metabolic diseases such as MSUD. And liver transplantation is an inborn error metabolism, is a dynamic process, and the indication for liver transplantation are changing and evolving. And finally, I want to thank all the OPBG metabolic transplant team that include the surgery team, the metabolic unit, the dietitian, the hepatology, nephrology and dialysis, laboratory, anesthesia and intensive care unit, psychology, liver imaging, neuroradiology, cardiology, and nurse coordination. But my final message is to improve patients' care and for a better understanding of the impact of organ transplantation on long-term disease course, we strongly recommend to involve metabolic clinicians in the multidisciplinary team managing the lifelong post-transplant follow-up. Thank you very much for your attention.